want to introduce my horses to you. So come on over here, Mel, to Dooley, and he's going to be our main example for grooming. And if any of you have ever had a black car, I know I used to have one. It was awful because it always looks dirty, especially if you live on a dirt road as we do. But as you can see, Dooley, he's technically not a black horse. He's technically a chestnut. I don't know if you can see down here on his legs. If you come close up, you might be able to see that he's chestnut in the legs, and that's kind of what defines him as a chestnut. But he's very black in his coat, and so he's going to show dirt. So these horses, we have not brushed them yet for the day. They did have they had blankets on. They had my horses are wearing their we just switched to the heavyweight blankets last week, and so they're wearing their blankets at night, and usually they have on a sheet or something during the day, so they're not too dirty, all things considered. But it's really dry here. We're having a drought, a little bit of a drought here. How about you guys? Is anybody out there having a drought at their home place? I know my one of my best friends lives in Alabama, and she says it's just awful there, the drought they've been going through. So consequently, we got a lot of dust around here, so it's a good time to talk about grooming. So, all right, well, let me grab. So I'll show you my first grooming tip here, and that is that most people that have been around me know I like to use two brushes for a lot of things, and so I like to start with a curry comb. But I have one in each hand, and it's sort of the wax on, wax off, you know, develop that coordination. It works out both sides of my body, which is important. It allows me to brush more in a stroking method and get all over the parts of the body. So, and then the main objective, I like the small size ones, because if you've ever met me in person, you probably know already that I'm not very tall. And I also, on top of being not very tall, have very small hands. So for me, the size of the brush that I use is important. I want it small enough that I can easily hold it in my hand. So I use these small size curry combs, and I get two exactly alike. They're soft rubber, which the horses like a lot. It feels like a massage. But the main goal here is that I want to really get down deep into the skin and the oils and bring up, come on close up, Mel. I'm going to start up here by his head. And I want to kind of massage in a circular motion. When my horses are thin coated, like in the summer, I don't, once their coats get really nice the way I like them, I don't do much roughing up of the hair, and when they're real thin coated, I just stroke with the hair with the curries, but I'm really trying to get down it deep into the skin, break loose all that oil and gunk and I don't know what you would call it, the dandruff and stuff that gathers on that skin. Plus they like it. I mean, let's go over here and look at Eddie and see how much he likes it. I feel like my horses ought to really enjoy their grooming. This is their time. And step over here and get your head in the sun so you can see what you look like. But for whatever reason, Eddie's just a horse that's always liked to have his neck scratched. This is his sweet spot. So when I'm using any brushes, I want to be using it in a massaging deep way, particularly with the curry comb, get down into that skin. And but if you can look at his lips, you can see that he's puckering them. And so when a horse puckers their lips, that's a good boy. It's a sign Mm-hmm. Horses pucker their lips when they feel pleasure. I suppose we do too. I don't know.
We both pay attention.
So, anyway, I like, and I'll show you while we're on the subject. You stay there and look at Eddie.
What a handsome one to look at.
Camel face. Plus. Debbie says camel face.
Okay, so here's another kind of curry comb, and this is a plastic curry comb. And I'm telling you, there's a ton of these on the market. They're everywhere. And they're cheap. They're like, you know what?
A buck or something.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of places not. You could find them for a buck. Right. At the most, you're going to pay $5 for them or whatever. However, well, first of all, here's a great tip. This brush is worn out. You know how you can tell? By the ends of the bristles. And so if you're using a brush, in fact, these curries, the more rounded the bristles get, the more worn out the brush. But if your brush starts developing a banana shape to it, it's worn out. It needs to be replaced. Go get a new one. Don't be so cheap. They only cost $5. But particularly for these, now, why might you ask? I don't know, Mel, can you see? Where's a good angle to where you can see how worn out that is right there? So it's, in other words, that should be square, these bristles right there. Why might I be using a brush that's this worn out and when they only cost $1 and I can get them anywhere? Actually, we have a ton of other ones. The reason why I use this one is the plastic. It's hard to describe. Feel it, Paula. The plastic's a little bit harder, and these needles are a little bit pointier, and so they're like scratching instead of rubbing, kind of.
Mm-hmm.
And I can tell you, because, and this is, I'll see if I can use it backwards, this is Eddie's favorite brush, and he'll really get his pucker factor going on this, because... particularly after we've ridden and he's sweaty, once his neck gets sweaty, oh my gosh, he gets so itchy. So anyway, here's my question to you. How many of you guys have a horse? How many of you know where your horse's sweet spot is? How many of you know where you have to rub and scratch your horse to get a pucker response? How many of you have a brush or a way of grooming that your horse really likes and yearns for? Another thing with Eddie is he suffers from what I call itchy face syndrome. And that's the other reason he likes his neck scratched. But with itchy face syndrome, as soon as he, when I'm riding and he breaks out in a sweat, first in the neck, or, you know, first around, they'll break out around the ears, then in the neck, but then they'll start actually breaking out around in the face. Once he starts breaking around the face, his face is so itchy, he can hardly stand it. And so, when we're finished riding, I like to rub down his face, and he loves it. And I just take the bridle off, and before I halter him, sometimes I'll get a damp rag if he's sweated a lot, but other times I'll just rub his face with my hands until, or a rag, or a dry or wet rag, until it's
good job, Dolly, because there's this behavior of horses known as mutual grooming, and it is the only known affectionate behavior that horses display, and everybody's seen it. Tell me if you've seen this or not. Two horses face each other, and they use their teeth to scratch each other on the withers. Now, come over here, Mel. Look at Dooley. So 80% of mutual grooming behavior occurs in this area around the withers, down the back, and to the dock of the tail. So the dock of the tail is a really favorite spot. I wouldn't say so much for any of my horses. I don't know, Mel, you know some of these horses better than I do, but Eddie's on easy. His is almost anywhere.
Yeah, so everywhere.
All right, so I just want to show you. I'm just going to do the body here where the sun is shining. So if I really get in here and curry this coat up on Dooley,
Can you guys hear okay? Tell me if you can hear okay. You can see how, static electricity's coming. Here's a great tip. You know how you get rid of it? Touch something metal. So I'm going to just get on the metal hitching rail there and get some of that static away from me. Also, we get static spray from the laundry department, put it on our blankets and stuff to control static electricity, which is really bad in the winter here. So go ahead and curry on his romp. So I like to do the legs too. I actually, I'll curry, of course, gently. Any place where there's bone, I'm going to be gentle. And of course, my horses are used to having their legs brushed. I'll even curry on their face and the large muscle areas. Anywhere there's a hair coat, you're going to benefit from a deep skin rub that you get out of the curry comb. And the job of the curry comb, as you can see on Dooley, come close up here, Mal. As you can see, it brought all the dust and dirt to the surface. You can see it here. You can probably see the dust coming off of them. So that's the job of the curry comb. Bring that all up to the surface. But now we want to get rid of this stuff. And here's where our new line of brushes comes in. So, I'll just pick these all up and show them to you one at a time. But save my favorite ones. This is the line of brushes. It's called Platinum, and they're made in Germany. They're imported from Germany. And of course, now we're getting into the European tradition of horsemanship, and it goes back not a few hundred years like it does in this country, but more like thousands of years. And of course, the German brand is widely regarded as highly engineered, high quality, high functionality. So I don't know, Twyla, where did we even
find
when we were up at Wisa? Mm-hmm. So we were we go up to Denver to the Western and English Trade Association market show every year, and we're always on the lookout for the newest, coolest, bestest product. By the way, that's where we discovered the hoof pick that we sell. Best ever hoof pick. Is it expensive? Yes. However, for a tool you use every day, multiple times a day, before you ride, after you ride, 4 feet, four horses, that's a lot of use. I think 18 bucks or whatever it is, and it's going to last. I mean, actually, I have one that a mouse chewed on, but I've seen a dog chew on it, but other than that, it's going to last forever. So anyway, the only reason we sell this hoof pick is because they're hard to find. It's a small company owned by a woman. A woman designed this tool to be easier to use than a traditional hoof pick. And so that was another reason we wanted to sell it. We wanted to support this woman-owned business. And anyway, so...
We got a question. Anita Moots is wondering why we braid the horse's tails.
Oh, good question. Okay, well, you really want to know what my horses do for a living? Is stand around and look good. That's mostly what they do. And entertain me and my husband. So in other words, I use my horses in photo shoots for magazine articles and catalogs, production of the TV show, developing video, educational content. Also, when we ride our horses, all of the horses that you see here are quarter horses. They're all actually bred to be cow horses. And they all work in very athletic ways. And so when we ride them, we have to put their tails up so they don't step on them. We keep them braided to keep them full and pretty. Obviously, when we take...
Or if they get red.
Yeah.
So one way to have a full tail, pull hair out, the more they swish flies and step on it, stomp on it and all that, the more hair gets pulled out and the tail gets thinner. So by keeping it braided, you don't have to comb it out. You see what Twala's doing, it's just picking out the hay and stuff that...
We lost audio. Okay, got it back.
Got it back?
Yep.
So anyway, we keep it braided because the more it is exposed to the elements, the more they swish their tails, stomp on it, step on it, chew on it, whatever. The more we brush it out because it gets tangled and it gets stick twigs in it or whatever. So if you keep them braided, the tail will get fuller and fuller over time. And then when we do have a photo shoot or a video or whatever, we let the tails down so they look good. So that's mostly what our horses do. Now, we work them every day. I mean, not every day. They don't work 7 days a week. But we kind of stay on a five-day-a-week schedule, although I rode both Saturday and Sunday this weekend. But so anyway, let's get back to the grooming. Tell me, that was a good question, by the way. Let us know if you have another one. So now we've got this new line of brushes. Let me dispel you of any notion that these are $5 brushes, because they are actually quite expensive, as you might imagine, since they're imported from Europe. So let's see, which one do I want to show you first? I'll get rid of this one first, because this is the only brush that I don't use in the collection, and the only reason I don't use it is because of its size. What is the this is the large body brush.
It is.
Uh-huh. And it's got a mixture of different bristles here. This is Rich's, and it's dirty already. Mostly because, yeah, it's really dusty right here now around here. But you can see that my hand kind of swims in there, and it's the brush itself is actually bigger than my hand. Why does everybody else but me love it? Well, let's see how where your hand is. Wait, wrong one. Do the other one.
Do the other one.
Okay. There, but, okay. So there's the difference in our hands. So this is just too big a brush for me. But why would you want it bigger? If your hand's not a midget like mine, why would you want it bigger?
Well, because you can cover more area.
Exactly.
Time's
so
always a factor for me.
It's going to be
yep.
Three strokes instead of five.
Exactly.
So, that's probably here. So you take
okay.
that. Look, and then you got the little midget.
The
actually, hold that for me. Hold these two. We'll do that. So this one's my favorite. So the two I have now are my two very most favorite of these four brushes. And if I could just have my little cheap $5 plastic curry comb and these two brushes, I'd probably be happy. Get some of the dust out. This is called a raised edge. Is that right?
Yeah.
It's a raised edge brush. Tell me what angle, Mel, that you can actually see that.
Right there is good.
So these black bristles in the middle are a little bit stiffer, a little bit tighter. They really pull the dirt away. And then this is like a softer, this is like a finish brush. So this is kind of like a body brush and a finish brush in one mm-hmm. brush. Mm-hmm. And so, actually, let me take your body brush.
Okay.
I didn't bring a body brush over here. Go ahead. So before we use, this is going to be more of our final brush. I'll go ahead and... brush just his body off here.
Just look at that dirt and dust that comes off with these brushes.
I think it's because they're short bristles.
I do too.
And they're stiff. Hey, Lucy, what are you doing over there?
She's hiding.
Oh. Come over here and tell us what you think about these brushes.
Susan Rixie says your hair looks great in a braid.
Oh, okay. Because if I unbraided it, it wouldn't look great at all. Okay. So, do you have one of these big neckmonkers? Yeah. You like that? Huh?
I do. But, and
yeah.
The horses.
Wow. Yeah. Just a little too big for me.
No, but Leonard comes up and goes, please trust me.
Yeah, you know, so the tip, another tip is to always use short strokes in a
how would you call it, kind of scooping kind of motion, because I don't want to smooth in the dirt. I'm trying to flick it off of there. And now I'm going to go up the flank and where the hair grows forward. So always, obviously, going with the hair, the way the hair grows. Okay,
take this big brush from me.
So now we get down to that raised edge brush. And I really like this one because it's going to really, you can see how much shine. I don't know if you can tell, you guys. Can you see the dust going away from his coat and the shine coming out with this brush? It's almost. Okay, so see how dusty this is right here? Can you see that on the camera?
Yep.
Okay.
And that shine will last, but even as dry as it is, I've noticed with my dark horses, that shine really lasts on them.
It really smooths the hair down good. Nice. Okay, so we're going to wrap this up pretty quick here. I'm just going to tell you, actually we have two more brushes. Let me show you the face brushes first. This is, I'm going to save the specialist one for last. No, is that a word, Heidi? Specialist?
She's cringing as you speak.
Hold that for me.
Okay.
These are the two finished brushes. These are my two that come with my kit, and I haven't used them on the horse yet. Because I've been using them on my face, and I've been using them to show people, this is like a makeup brush for your horse. And this is a finished body brush. Finish. The absolute last thing you would do. I'm not going to use it on the horse because I'm still using it on my face. I will in a minute. This is the face brush. So we got a body size one and a face size one. How many of you have thin skin sensitive horses?
Yep.
Any hot-blooded horse, Arabs, thoroughbred, head shy horse. Many horses, and I like to point out to people, would you want someone else coming and rubbing your face and, you know, doing all that kind of stuff in your face? Horses can be very sensitive. Dooley is a very, very, very sensitive horse, and so to really get those eyes clean and brush around the face, brush around those nostrils, that's what these little face brushes are for. Use on the eyes where I can really get in there and get all that dust cleaned out of there. Brush in these really sensitive places, the nose, getting it in there, even in the nostril. This face brush is awesome. Now I've ruined it for using them on myself. But I told both my farrier and my vet that wouldn't they like one of these in their truck? And after you went on a hard call and your face was all for here, pan around up there looking to the west, Mel, so you can see that we are up in the mountains, and where you're looking towards now is where the Continental Divide is. It's not very far away, about 10-15 miles up there, and the wind just howls through here, and so we get a lot of wind. It's very, very dry, a lot of dry dust, a lot of dirt. Those eyes get caked up with dirt and stuff. But wouldn't it be nice when you're out there in that dirt and you got a filthy face, just have this in your truck where you can get your eyes and oops, I forgot I had makeup on. Okay. So we'll go ahead and try the body brush on Dooley here. And I didn't really do a very thorough job of just kind of doing a cursory blow here, but after finished brush or is the last thing you're going to do, really get that shine on the horse. Anyway, so the last brush we want to talk about, I think, is the coolest brush in the collection. It's my favorite. As you can see, it's platinum, made in Germany. We have not found many sources that you can buy these brushes. You can't buy them on Amazon. You can't buy them online. Anyway, you can see it's got this little raised part here. Can you see that now? And so
So in the middle, it's raised about, what, half inch? There. And this is called a pastern brush. And what this leg is specifically for is, what this brush is specifically for is brushing the leg. So I can start up here, and look how this part really gets into those tendons. You know how your brushes will tend to skip on top of the grooves here, where the tendons between the cannulbone and the tendon? So you'll get in there, you get, the reason why it's called the pastern brush is because you can get in here behind the pastern, and because of this raised part here, you actually get down deep into that, and you can really keep those pasterns clean. And how many of you guys have trouble with mud cracks or getting even just mud caked in there, mm-hmm. which ultimately leads to funguses and scratches and these conditions in the skin that are terrible in the pastern? All of that starts with being clean and dry and moist. So getting in there to the pastern is awesome, down on the on the coronary band. And then best of all, you can get in here behind your horse's leg and get in these grooves that are even harder to get to than awesome. These ones on the outside. So I can get the inside of my horse's legs brushed. I'll reach over here and do the offside. And so that's the pastern brush. And it's the coolest brush of all in this collection. So we've got all these brushes available online. I think they make great Christmas gifts, whether you gave just one of them to someone or the whole set.